I was told my whole life, like, you should be praying, you should be saying this, you should be doing that. And I took that as, okay, well, I'm going to go and do this because I should be, not because I really wanted to or felt a connection to God. It was just based off of what I was told. But I never really felt connected in church. So I kind of got lost during my teenage years, got in my car accident, flip forward to 17 years old. And my car, like, basically submerged completely into water. And I hit the surface of the water when I got out of it. And I remember just taking a huge gasp of air and just being like, God, I'm just pleading to God and be like, hi, I know I haven't really spoken to you like a lot lately. And I remember just being like, God, I will do whatever you need me to do, whatever you want me to do, whatever you guide me to do, if you just help me in this moment. And then I looked across the street from where I was also, and there was a church. Fast forward to 21, I moved to Nashville. Still at this point, didn't really find a church. And then I had a friend that works at Goodwill with me. And I remember she was just like, come to church with me. And I was like, no, absolutely not. I'm not a church person. And she was like, just try it out. And I remember walking into Cross Point. I finally, in the first time in my whole life, I felt like I had a family. And that for me was a big thing, because like, I have family, but I never felt like I was in a family or like I was loved in a family. I always felt like there was something missing in my life when it came to community. Like, I felt very fulfilled in a lot of aspects, but it was kind of empty when it came to like my church community. And when I walked into Cross Point, it was just like, okay, I belong here. I'm welcomed here. I can come in a baseball cap and jeans, or I can come like dressed up, and I don't feel like I don't belong. Like, I feel very at home and at peace. And that for me was something I was searching for so long that I had no clue that I didn't have. I mean, just put all your faith in God, honestly. I know that sounds, I guess, cliche or whatever, like, for people that don't, they're just like, how do you just do that? I'm like, you just have to kind of like release it, like everything in your life, and just be like, God's got you. Because every other aspect of my life that I've been like, okay, why are you doing this? Or why am I questioning? He's been like, my child, I'll show you the way, and I'll take your anxiety and your fear away. And if you just put everything in his hands, like, it's the best thing you could do in your life. And it's so fulfilling, yeah.
Can we just say thank you? Thank you to Katie for sharing your story and just your vulnerability and your heart. And as I was listening to that, and I've listened to it many times, and each time, that moment where she talks about being submerged underwater in that accident, being submerged underwater in her automobile, and then just coming up and coming for breath. Like, when I hear her say that, I've never been in an accident like that, but maybe you're like me, you know those moments in life where you feel overwhelmed, or you feel submerged, or you feel a measure of anxiety or pressure or stress or tension to the point where you're like, I just need to come up for breath. I need to be able to breathe. And my hope and my prayer for today is that today would be a day where you could just breathe, where you could breathe in, breathe deep the love of God, the peace of God, the grace of God, His presence. You'd be able to just breathe. And so I just want to invite you, just take a deep breath. Now just breathe out. You just do that again. Breathe out. Somebody's sitting there going, I knew this was that kind of church. Y'all were doing that. It's good to be able to breathe. You know, the Hebrew word for salvation is yesha. And it means to be rescued. It means to be saved. It means to, like, open space above you. Like, the idea is that there is this open space that you go from this constricted, from this submerged, from this held under space to this place where you can breathe again. And there is a Hebrew word, Yeshua, which means God saves. And that He is the one who saves. And the Hebrew translation of that word in the Old Testament is Joshua, but in the Greek New Testament, that word is translated Jesus. That Jesus is the one who saves. that Jesus is the one who rescues, that Jesus is the one, he is that open space, that he is the one who leads us to the open space where we can breathe again, that he is the giver of life. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said he has come that we would have life and have it to the full, that we would be able to breathe again, that we would be able to take in that breath, that we would have that open space. He's come to deliver us, to set us free, to rescue us. He is our rescuer. And my prayer is today for you that you would breathe deep in the love of God. But sometimes if we've known Jesus for a while, we can forget what it was like to not know Jesus. We can forget what it was like to not have peace, to not have hope, to not have joy. And in a time like Easter, when we look toward the resurrection, an opportunity like Easter to help other people find Christ. I mean, many of us, we know friends, family, coworkers. We have people in our lives who are close to us but far from God. And so Easter gives us this amazing opportunity to extend an invitation that they would experience the hope that Jesus offers. And so I want to invite you to be talking with God. God, would you bring names and faces, people to mind that I could extend an invitation for them to experience the life change and the hope that Jesus can give? And we're going to partner. We're praying toward. We're preparing. We're planning. We're partnering with God together to see what he could do in us and what he could do through us this Easter. So we're looking forward to next week. Today, we're in a series, week five of a series called King of Hearts, where we're looking at the Gospel of Mark, and we're working through the Gospel of Mark together. And just to remind you, in the Gospel of Mark, it is a letter that Mark wrote detailing Jesus' life, talking about Jesus' life. It's a gospel account that Mark has given us, and he's writing it to non-Jews. He's writing to non-Jews saying, Jesus is not just King of the Jews, he's King of the world. Jesus is not just King of the Jews, he's King of the Gentiles. He's not just King of Israel, he's King of Rome. He's not just King of Bethlehem, he's King of Bellevue. He's not just King of Damascus, he's King of Dixon. He's King of the Mount of Olives and King of Mount Juliet. That took some work. He's King of Lebanon and King of Lebanon. He's King of the Middle East and King of Middle Tennessee. That Jesus is King, and he came to bring his kingdom. He came to bring his power and his presence, his rule and his reign. He came for us to get in on life with God. And life with God is for everybody. Everybody can get in on life with God. And Jesus came to kick the door down so that we can get in on life with God, so we can experience a with God life. And Jesus has a lot to teach us about what life in the kingdom is like. And we see what life is in the kingdom is like by looking at the king. And so when we look at the life of Jesus, we see his humility. And so today I want to talk about the humility of Jesus. And I want us to look at Mark chapter 11. In the reading, Mark chapter 11 tells the story of the triumphal entry. It is Palm Sunday on the church calendar. Palm Sunday bookends this holy week between Palm Sunday and Easter, these 7 days, which are the final 7 days of Jesus' earthly life. And a lot happened in those final 7 days. And what is wild is when you go through and read the gospel accounts, how much time these gospel writers devote towards 7 days of Jesus' life. I mean, you go back and you read through the stories, and you see that Luke spends 33% of his gospel talking about 7 days of Jesus' life. Matthew spends 40% of his gospel account writing about Jesus' life, Jesus' final 7 days. John, 50% of the gospel of John is Jesus' final 7 days. And for Mark, 60%, 60% of the gospel account is the final 7 days of Jesus' life. 7 days of Jesus' 33 years is 0.05% of his life. So just think about that. 60% of the account is devoted to 0.05% of Jesus' life. Now, I've never written a biography, but I think it says something when the letter or when the story of Jesus' life is devoted, it says something about the significance of what happened in those final 7 days, because the final 7 days, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, that it is how we come up for breath. It is what has delivered us from sin and death and hell, but you need to know that salvation is more than the forgiveness of sins, that it is where we find life. It is where we find peace. It is where we find grace. It is not just for a hereafter. It is for here and now. That we would receive oxygen from heaven. That we receive the life of Jesus. And so we're going to look at the triumphal entry. And there are really only a couple stories that are found in all four Gospels. But the triumphal entry is one of them. And I want us to look at Mark chapter 11. If you got a Bible, you can turn there. We're going to pick up in verse 1. And it says, "And as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, 'Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you doing this? Say, the Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly.' And they went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. And they untied it. And some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' And they answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. And when they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. And many people spread their cloaks along the road, and while others spread branches, they cut in the fields. And those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna,' or 'Hoshana. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven.' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12." Now, anytime I read that story, it triggers a memory of the Waffle House. And I've shared this story maybe once before, but it's one that... I want to share again because it marked my life. I was sitting at the Waffle House with one of my mentors, friends of mine, Ronnie Brasfield. He's an old retired chicken farmer, and everybody needs an old retired chicken farmer in their life. In my phone, he is Chicken Man, and so we were sitting at the Waffle House. I just started a ministry job, and I was finishing up an All-Star special, and doing the Lord's work, and I was sitting there with Ronnie, and he said, "Hey, I want to read something to you." He read this passage to me, and we get done with this passage. He said, "I got a word for you. I think it's from God." And as I was beginning that ministry job, he said, "Kevin, here's the word. Be the donkey." He said, "Be the donkey." I'm like, "Be the what?" He said, "Be the donkey. Be the donkey that gives divinity a ride." He said, "It'd been easy for that donkey to get confused that day, walking down that street with crowds surrounding him, saying, 'Hosanna, Hosanna,' throwing down their cloaks, people cheering. It'd be easy for that donkey to start strutting. It'd be easy for that donkey to think that it was about him. But that donkey would be confused because it wasn't about the donkey. It was about who the donkey was carrying." He said, "Kevin, don't be a confused donkey. Be the donkey that gives divinity a ride." I'll never forget that. Everybody needs a retired chicken farmer in their life. They do. We need that truth. I'm telling you, there's like when I step up to teach, there's a prayer that I pray and a mantra that I say. The prayer that I pray is, "Make me thy chosen chalice that gives drink that makes men and women whole." Reminds me that I'm just a vessel and that Jesus is the living water. He's the only one that can satisfy the heart. But then I also say the mantra is, "Be the donkey." Just be the donkey. Because what it's a reminder is that humility, that really that's a reminder of humility, to take the humble posture of like, "Jesus, I want people to see you. I don't want them to see me, I want them to see you." And so that mantra works no matter what we do in life, whether we're in business or in the marketplace, whether you're a teacher or a coach, mom or dad, student, if you're in retail, if you're a designer, an artist, creative, whatever you do, that when we take those moments in life, when we step into what we do, that we would say, "God, would you help me be the donkey? That I would be the donkey that gives divinity a ride, that when people see our lives, that they don't see us, but that they see Jesus. That through our humility, he would be on display," because Jesus is the most humble king. He's the most humble person to ever walk the planet. That the one with the greatest glory is most humble. And humility is the pathway to greatness. I mean, the scriptures teach in 1 Peter 5:8, it says, "Humble yourself, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you in due time." Let's humble ourselves under God's mighty hand so that he would lift us. He'd be able to lift us up. The scripture before that, the verse before that says that God oppresses the proud, but that he gives grace to the humble. It literally, like when we have a posture, a position of pride, that says God works in opposition. But he says if we humble ourselves, that he lifts us up. He would literally lift us up in due time. That humility is the pathway to greatness in the kingdom. And humility is this healthy, Tim Keller says, it's a healthy self-forgetfulness. It's this others focusness. There was a book called Good to Great, written back in 2001. It was by Jim Collins. Great book. And it wasn't just a good book. It was a great book called Good to Great. And it was, dad moment. But it was this fascinating read where Jim Collins, where he studied over 1,000 companies that took the journey from being a good company, enduring into greatness. And he studied the CEOs or the leaders of those companies and what he was looking for. What were the common threads? Or what were the common themes of their leadership that helped them become great and helped the companies become great? And he whittled it down to two of what he called level five leaders, two qualities of level five leaders. And the first one he called, it was humility. It was humility. He called it an others-focused life. So he said the humility. And then the second was a fierce resolve. Like there was this fierce resolve. And as I was looking at that, I was thinking, you know what? That, like, the gospel's in there. Because Jesus is the most humble leader. He's the most humble king. He's the most humble one to ever walk the earth. And there is no one with a more fierce resolve than Jesus. It says his face was turned toward Jerusalem. His face was turned like flint. There was this resolve, this resolute spirit in him that he was going toward Jerusalem, knowing that it would cost him his life, that he would lay down his life for us. Humility and a fierce resolve in Jesus. There is no one that's more humble than Jesus. And when Jesus is the king of our heart, he forms his heart in us. And I don't know about you, but I know about me that I live in this tension. I live in this battle between pride and humility, between control and surrender, between ego and serving others, between being self-focused and others focus, between being the donkey that gives divinity a ride and being a donkey. I live in this, I'm the only one, evidently. I'm the only one. I live in this tension between two. And here's what I found in my life, that the more that Jesus is on the throne of my life, the more there is this surrender. And this capacity to see others, to serve others. And I want to become a more humble person. I want to grow in humility. And what we know from leadership is that leaders shape culture. And the more Jesus is the CEO of our hearts, the more that he is the leader, the Lord of our hearts, the more the culture of our lives becomes like his presence, which is humility. And so how do we grow in humility? Well, what I want to do is I want to take this passage that we've read through, and I want us to look at some key observations, what I believe some key observations on humility from this passage. So if you're taking out notes, first thing you can write down is that Jesus doesn't demand praise or promote himself. Humility doesn't demand praise or promote self. I read a story one time about a flight that was delayed. Anybody ever had a flight that was delayed? You know what that's like. And there was a long line at the counter, and that agent was working meticulously to try to reroute all the customers. And there was this guy in the back of the line who just wasn't having it. He was standing back there, and he was fuming because he had more status, and he had more clout, and he had more miles than everybody else. And so he made his way up front, and he cut in line. And when he got up to the counter, he pounded his fist on the counter, and he said, "Do you know who I am?" The agent didn't miss a beat. She grabbed the microphone. She said, "Ladies and gentlemen, if anyone has lost an adult male in your party, he is at the counter and apparently does not know who he is." Just a legendary moment right there. Jesus knows who he is. He knew exactly who he is. He said, "I am the bread of life. I am the Son of God." He said, "I am the light of the world." He says, "I am the good shepherd." Jesus knows who he is. He is not struggling with self-esteem. His humility did not come from insecurity. It came from love, from an other's focus. And humility is revealed in how we treat others. And Jesus didn't promote himself, and he didn't demand praise. You never see Jesus bang his fist on the table demanding praise. But he says, "I knock on the door of your heart." He knocks. He asks us to praise him, but he doesn't demand it. In fact, when you look at Jesus' life, he doesn't promote himself. He lets other people do that. He asks Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says, "That's good, Peter." Pilate says, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus said, "You said it." Jesus, he enables other people to promote him and to praise him. He asks for it, but he doesn't demand it. I think about the Proverbs, like Jesus is the personification of Proverbs 27:2. It says, "Let someone else praise you and not your own mouth, an outsider and not your own lips." I read about Tim Tebow growing up, and he said that he and his brothers were all, you know, great athletes and that they were highly competitive. And his parents had a rule at the dinner table, and the rule was this, that you couldn't brag on your own accomplishments, but that you could only talk about your accomplishments when somebody asked a question and you could celebrate somebody else. And Tebow said that that was where he learned the value of celebrating others more than complimenting himself. And you know it's an act of God when I use a Florida Gator as an illustration, but but Jesus doesn't do, he doesn't do self-praise or self-promotion. And his strategy is still to this day that others would praise him and that others would promote him. But he tells us that one day there's going to be a day where every knee will bow and every tongue will confess in heaven and under the earth. Every tongue will confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, to the glory of God the Father. That one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. There will come a day where everyone will praise him, where we will all see him rightly and we will all bow before him. But until that day, we have a choice. And what we do with our lives, that we promote Jesus, that we praise Jesus, that we let other people know that he is worthy of praise and that he is the one who delivers and that he is the one who rescues and who brings life. And Jesus never demands praise, but he never turns it away. He welcomes for us. He wants our praise. And that we get to make a choice to praise him. And the second thing we see about Jesus' humility is that Jesus trusts God's timing. Humility trusts God's timing. 1 Peter, that passage says that in due time, God will raise you up. He'll raise you up in due time. And the thing is, oftentimes due time is not our time. And you know God has a plan for you, that God has dreams for your life, that God has things he wants to do. And if we humble ourselves, he says, I will lift you up in due time. And what we see about Jesus is Jesus trusted the Father's timing. In fact, this was kind of the first time where Jesus is public with who he is. Where, I mean, up until this point, he was kind of low key that he was the Messiah, that he was the King of the Jews. He didn't broadcast it until this moment, until the triumphal entry. You see, before this, that he didn't let it be known. I mean, it was like ones and twos, but this is kind of the first time that he goes public with this. But there were signals along the way. I mean, because there were 12 tribes in the nation of Israel, and how many disciples did he have? 12. There were 72 evangelists that he sent out, and there were 71 Sanhedrin, which were kind of like the Jewish Supreme Court. But this is the first time that he goes big and goes public. Why? Why did he wait until this moment to let everybody know? Because Israel already had a king. And because Judea already had a governor, Pilate, and because Rome already had an emperor. And the moment Jesus declares that he's king, the clock starts ticking. He's only got a short time left. The 7 days start happening. And this is where the donkey comes in. See, there was a prophecy that was written 500 years before Jesus, before his life, before his ministry. There was a prophecy that was written by the prophet Zechariah. Let me share it with you. Zechariah 9:9. It says, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." See, when we think of donkeys, we think of Shrek. When they thought of donkeys, they thought of royalty. They thought of a king. And in fact, there was another prophecy from the prophet Zechariah. Look what he says, Zechariah 14:4. It says, "On that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives east of Jerusalem." So in that moment, they're seeing donkey, Mount of Olives, the Messiah. And all of this came together on Passover, which was like their declaration of independence. It was like their 4th of July. So all those things are coming together. And that's why they put their cloaks down like red carpet. That's why they declare with palm branches, which were a symbol of freedom. And so they're waving palm branches. That's why they sang freedom songs. Like in You look back in Psalm 118, Hosanna, blessed he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. This is kingdom language. They're saying our king has arrived. He's come to set us free from the Romans. But they didn't know that he had come to set them free from their sin. His agenda was greater than delivering them from the Roman Empire. It was to deliver them from sin and death and hell and from the evil one. They thought he's come to smite our enemies. They didn't know that he'd come to die for their enemies too. See, sometimes the Savior that we need is different than the Savior that we want. Jesus came to save them from something greater right there in that moment. And so they're praising him, Hosanna. They're praising him to deliver them, and he would. But the Pharisees, they're trying to put a stop on. In Luke 19:39, some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." See, Jesus is humble. He doesn't demand their praise, but he's not going to resist their praise. And he says, if this group doesn't praise me, then another group will, all the way down to the stones. Because he is the king of all creation. And he's looking for people who would choose to praise him, who would take a deep breath of who he is, and that would breathe out praise, that would give him praise. And he trusts God's timing and all of this coming together. The third thing that amazes me about Jesus' humility is how he depends on others' generosity. Jesus depends on others' generosity. In Psalm 24:1, it says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it." So what this teaches us is that everything belongs to Jesus. But what amazes me is that he just humbles himself and he borrows things. You know, he borrowed a manger to be born in. He borrowed a donkey to ride in on. He borrowed an upper room for the Last Supper. He borrowed a tomb that he would give back. See, Jesus, it all belongs to him, but Jesus, in his humility, he borrows. That he's willing to make himself vulnerable to the generosity of other people. It's pretty amazing. I mean, he could have taken things, but Jesus and sometimes to receive things, like we have a hard time receiving things, and oftentimes that's pride. Especially if you're a person who gives, it can be hard to receive. And sometimes that's pride that keeps us from being willing to receive. But Jesus he's willing to receive. I mean, let me tell you something I've learned is that when God wants to give us a hug, oftentimes he uses other people. And when we can't receive, we're like a person. Have you ever tried to hug somebody that doesn't want to hug? It's hard. If you're going to give somebody a buckle-to-buckle hug, like it requires, like there's a moment of like being, and when God wants to hug you, oftentimes he'll use the generosity of other people. But our pride can keep us from being willing to receive. And when God wants to give other people a hug, oftentimes he'll use us. And so it's humility to be willing to give as well. And in this story, Jesus says, there's going to be a donkey. And a donkey in that day was used for transportation, take things to the market, used for work. It's like an F-150. And how many know if you have a truck, people want to borrow it? They got this colt, you got an F-150, it's never been driven before. Right? And Jesus says, go to the town and you're gonna be able to borrow that. So think about being one of the disciples. These two disciples, Jesus sends them on a mission. They're like, all right. They go and they see this donkey. And they're like, Jesus said, go. And so Jesus said, go untie it. Well, Jesus said. So they go start and untie it. The owner comes out and they're like, what are you doing? And they said, the Lord needs it. And he goes, oh. It's like a Jedi mind trick. The Lord needs it. And they're like, okay, here you go. Offers up this. And so then they take the donkey. And we don't know. Maybe the owner of this donkey, like maybe he had a relative who was healed by Jesus. Or maybe he heard him teach. And he knew who the Lord is. And he knew who the Lord is. He knew who the one who owned it all. And so he was like, here you go. And so he offers up this donkey. And so they take the disciples. Oh, man, this is crazy. This is not permission that if you see an F-150 that's never been ridden and you see the keys in it, this is not permission to just get in and drive and go, the Lord needs it. That doesn't work. You'll get shot. That's not what that, do not do that. But like in that moment, what we see is we see God bringing all these things together in this prophecy that was given 500 years before because some anonymous person's generosity, Jesus enters into the scene. I think if that person said no, Jesus would have found somebody else. But the person who would have held on to their donkey rather than sharing in that moment, they would have missed being a part of the story. I've heard it said this way, that Jesus still rides into cities on the backs of generosity. That anytime you see God move in a city, anytime you see God move in somebody's life, it's because somebody gave. Anytime you see somebody come to Christ at Crosspoint, it's because somebody gave. Anytime you see a child grow in their faith, somebody gave. Anytime you see a student step up for leadership, it's because somebody gave. Anytime you see a marriage restored, it's because somebody gave. Anytime you see people gathering together in groups and communities, it's because somebody gave. Anytime you see a serve out in the city, because somebody gave. Anytime you see us working with strategic partners locally, it's because somebody gave. Anytime we're planting churches and overseas, it's because somebody gave. Anytime somebody's baptized, it's because somebody gave. And you're a generous church. And because of your generosity, Jesus still rides into cities on the backs of generosity. But I want you to think about that guy who said, here, you can use my donkey. He never looked at that donkey the same way again. I mean, imagine him. He's standing in the crowd. Jesus is riding into the city and he's looking. He's going, that's my donkey. He's telling people, that's my donkey. That's my donkey. He's riding. Donkey comes back. And he has a donkey at the house. Everybody who comes over the house for dinner, he's like, let me tell you a story. You want to see the donkey? I mean, there's like, take him out here. Look right over here. And he's like, this is the colt. And he's like, hey. Because Jesus used it. Anytime we entrust things to Jesus, he puts a story on it, a story that gives him glory. And so saying with open hands. So let me ask you a question. When was the last time that God put on your heart, the Lord needs it? And how'd you respond? When was the last time you sensed God saying, the Lord needs it? And how did you respond? Because it's when we live open-handed with what we have, when we share what we have, when we give of what we have to help others, it's how God gives other people a hug. But at the same time, it's how he breaks the grip of greed on our hearts. And if we don't allow the grip of greed to be broken, we'll end up loving things and using people instead of using things and loving people. Humility is living open-handed. God, everything I have comes from you. How can I serve? How can I help others? So just to kind of give a recap where we've been, humility doesn't demand praise. Humility trusts in God's timing. Humility is willing to give and receive. And then last, humility serves. Our humility is revealed in how we treat others, especially when we don't get our way. Our humility is revealed in how we treat others, especially when we don't get our way. Fast forward through the Holy Week, it takes us to Thursday. Thursday is Maundy Thursday, but it's the time when Jesus was with his disciples in the upper room. They borrowed an upper room for the Passover meal, which was a meal that they would do to remind them of their historical deliverance from Egypt, that God had set them free. And Jesus takes this Passover meal, has that meal with his disciples. And he says, I've been so looking forward to this moment with you. And as they're gathered for this meal, Jesus knows. He knows what's going to happen in 24 hours. He knows in the next 24 hours that Peter would deny him and Judas would betray him. All the disciples would desert him, that he'd be tried on trumped up charges, and that the Romans would put him on a cross. Imagine knowing all of those details and trying to have dinner. I asked my kids, can you tell when I'm stressed at a meal? And they were all like, yeah. I said, how can you tell I'm stressed? They're like, you shut down. Like, you shut down. I just stopped talking. What's amazing about this is Jesus knows what's coming and he doesn't shut down. That he leans in with love. He's having conversation with them. And in having conversation and hosting them at the table, he looks and realizes somebody forgot to get a foot washer. And feet needed to be washed. And that day, you didn't want dirty feet at the table. They would put their feet out to the side. And so Jesus is looking around. He's like, somebody needs to wash feet. And instead of delegating that or calling for a servant, Jesus gets up from the table. He goes and gets a basin and gets a towel. And he goes down. He begins to wash the disciples' feet. And he washes all 12 disciples' feet, which means he washes Peter's feet and he washed Judas' feet. The one he knew that would betray him, he washed his feet. The one he knew who would betray him, he washed his feet because he still wanted to save Judas. He still wanted to rescue him. He still wanted to create an off-ramp for Judas. But he couldn't save Judas unless Judas wanted to be saved. And so he washed his feet, washed Peter's feet, all the disciples, and then he fed them. He fed them at the table. I mean, nobody's loved us like Jesus. And we've been like Peter, or we've been like Judas. We've denied him, or we've betrayed him. He still loves us. And he feeds them at the table. Verse 22, it says, and while they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take it, this is my body. And then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, he said to them. Truly, I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Who is this King of Glory who rides into the city on the back of a donkey? This King who humbles himself and serves. This King who washes feet because feet needed to be washed. Who is this King who feeds those, even those who would betray him and deny him? Our King is Jesus. And he shares this meal with them, and he takes the elements and he invites them to a moment. And he says, I want you to remember. I want you to remember me. I want you to remember the covenant of my love. And so I want to invite you to get the elements in your hands that you were handed when you came in today. And think about this, for 2,000 years, as followers of Jesus, this has been a practice, this has been a moment. We've entered into a sacred moment at all of our campuses. I want to invite you into, and I'm going to walk with you through this. I'm going to tell you, this is for those who are followers of Jesus. If you're not yet a follower of Jesus, you don't have to partake in this. Maybe today this is a, kind of that first step of saying, I want to receive God's forgiveness. I want to receive his salvation. I want to begin to follow Jesus. Well, I invite you, this can be your prayer to him. Said, this is my body. So I want to invite you to take the top layer and to remove it. That you would take the bread and the wafer. And as you look at it, I want you to think about that truth that his body was broken for you. He suffered for you. He laid his life down willingly for you. That he is your sustenance. That he is your strength. That he is the bread of life. And you just thank him. And when you're ready, you can partake. And we open up the cup. Jesus said, this cup is the cup of the new covenant. My promise to you, my blood was shed for you. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. But because his blood was shed for us, we are made as white as snow. So do this in remembrance of me. You can thank him for his blood that was shed and partake. I'm going to pray for us, and we're going to have a moment to respond in praise. I'm going to take a moment before we respond in praise, and maybe you just want to let the band sing a moment over you. The truth of remembrance. Just breathe in the truth of who he is, and then we'll exhale and praise together. Let me pray for us. Father, we thank you. We thank you for a humble king. A humble king who is on the throne. And that one day every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, to the glory of God the Father. We make it our choice to worship you, Jesus. Thank you that you are our salvation, that you are our deliverer, that you are our rescue. We breathe deep of that truth. And then we sing out in praise, that our lives would be as praise unto you. Hosanna, our Savior.